Okay, so we have seen how the identity operator, has a convenient representation in terms of the summation of these EIEI operators of some orthonormal basis, right? So we will look at a similar expression for what are called projection operators in this lecture, and connect it to the notion of the direct sum of subspaces. Okay, so let V be some vector space, and we can think of a bunch of subspaces, V1, V2, so on, with the following conditions, right? So any two subspaces, Vi and Vj, have only a single element, precisely one element, which is common to them, right? That's the null vector, right? So since all of them are subspaces, all of them must have the null vector, and so that's the only common element. So suppose we construct a bunch of subspaces in this manner, and every vector in V can be uniquely decomposed as a sum over vectors belonging to V1, V2, so on, all the way up to Vn, right? So that is, for example, if you have a vector x, then there you will be able to find vectors xi, where xi belongs to vi, all the way I going all the way from 1 to n, and which yields a unique decomposition. X can be written as x1 plus x2 plus x3 all the way up to xn. And if this is the way you have constructed your subspaces, and it's possible to do so, I will give you examples, then we say that V, the overall space, is a direct sum of V1, V2, so on, all the way up to Vn, which is written as V1 plus this, this symbol, V2, so on, all the way up to Vn. Right? So one immediate example which comes to mind is that of 3D vector space. Right? So 3D vector space, has all kinds of vectors, but there is a subclass of this, which is the set of vectors which all live on the x-axis, which point along the x-axis. Now, there is another subspace, Viz, which corresponds to all vectors which live in the yz plane. Right, so the only vector which is common to these two subspaces is the origin, the null vector. Right, so the null vector is the only vector which is common to both of these spaces, and any vector in general can be written as the sum of vectors drawn from these two spaces, like exactly like the requirement. So therefore we can write V is equal to Vx direct sum Vyz. But Vyz itself, by the same, by a similar procedure, we can break Vyz itself into Vy and Vz. We can introduce the set Vy as a set of all vectors which lie along the y-axis, and Vz as a set of all vectors which lie along the z-axis. So in fact, we can write this overall space V as the direct sum of Vx, Vy, and Vz, right? So this is the idea of a direct sum decomposition, right, of a bigger space in terms of many subspaces. And there's a very tight way of doing this, such that there is no redundancy, right, between the subspaces. Now, let's look at the idea of projection operators, right? So we have seen that if you have some orthonormal basis for the overall space V, right? And subspaces have their own orthonormal bases, right? But let's say that we are thinking of this orthonormal basis E1, E2, all the way up to En for the vector space V. Now, we have seen that if you consider this operator, summation over IEIEI is the identity operator, right? Now, if you don't keep all of these, right, or if you keep only one of these, let's say. So if you consider this operator E1, E1, then that's nothing but I minus summation over I going from 2 to n, EI, EI. Now this operator is an example of what is called a projection operator, right? Think of what this operator does to get a feeling for what it is, right? If you take this operator and or act upon any vector of your full space, it will necessarily give you a vector within the subspace only, right? So we can see this P1 acting on X will give you, inner product of E1 X. So it'll pull out the component of that vector along the only direction that is represented. E1 is the only unit vector. So it will pull out the component of that vector in that space and give you, and its direction is E1 now, right? I mean, you can think of this as representing a direction, E1. Now, it's clearly a vector within the subspace, right? One of the essential properties of an operator to be a projector operator is something we can verify for P1, which is that P1 squared is equal to P1 itself, right? So think of what P1 squared is doing, right? So P1 will take any vector in general and bring it, it will project it onto the space itself. Now, if you try to project this vector which has already been projected into this space a second time, that's what P1 squared is doing, then there should be no change, right? So P1 squared is the same as P1. So there is no need to project a vector which has already been projected. So that's the physical content of this statement, P1 squared equal to P1. So this is, in fact, a way to check whether an operator is a projector or not, is to verify if P1 squared is equal to P1. Now, next we can check that, you know, I said E1 is a projection operator, but in fact I minus E1 is also a projection operator. You can check this, right? 2, 3, we can think of this as a bigger space. It's projecting onto not a space with just one basis element. It's not a dimension one space, but it's a dimension n minus one space, right? So the dimension can be small, dimension can be big of your subspace, but there are projection operators which collect together, some basis elements of that subspace, and if you create an operator of this kind belonging to some space, that becomes a projector. Now, this is something that you should verify, right? You should take this operator, I minus E1 square it and check that indeed you get back the same operator, right? So this is something for you to do as exercise, right? So since that is an essential requirement for this to be a project. Also, you can try to, operate with this on any state and show that it will always lie in this subspace. Okay, so in general, we can decompose the overall n-dimensional vector space V into m subspaces, right? It may be equal to, this m may be equal to n, or it may be some other number, but you can break down your overall space into many subspaces, right? We have seen that there is this direct sum decomposition. So suppose we do this, we can find projectors corresponding to each of these subspaces. So in fact, you can find any basis in V1, any basis for V2, any basis for each of the VIs all the way up to VM, and use something like this type of an operation within the basis of that subspace, and you will get a projector for that subspace. Now, these projectors are going to project any vectors from the overall space into the subspace. Pi acting on x will be an element of vi, for every x is an element of v. And each of these operators must satisfy the condition pi squared equal to pi, right? If it doesn't, then it's not a projector. The product of any two such projectors is also interesting, and it's going to vanish because of the nature in which you have divided these subspaces. Right, there is a direct sum decomposition. So the overlap between any two subspaces is, there is just the null vector, which is the only common element between any two subspaces. So if you consider such a decomposition, and if you construct these projection operators, then EIPJ is going to vanish unless I is equal to G. Right? So we can see this, from considering PI, PJ, what this product does to an operator x to a vector x, an arbitrary vector x which is an element of V. So pjx, right, because that's the property of a projection operator, is going to bring it to a vector which lies in the space vj. Now, if you take pi and act upon this vector which lies in vj, then this, since it lies in vj, which is which is an orthogonal space to pi, so it's not going to have any component in VI, right? Now, PI is going to try to project this vector's component in VI, but the only common vector between VI and VJ is the null vector. So in fact, all that PI is going to manage when it acts upon any vector from VJ is to give you the null vector, and that's what happens. Therefore, PIPJ acting on X is going to give you the null vector for an arbitrary vector X is an element of V, and therefore PIPJ itself is the null operator. So a compact way of stating these properties is to say, you know, PIPJ is equal to delta IJ PI, right? When I is equal to J, PI squared is going to PI, right? If I is not equal to J, then PI times PI is the null operator. Okay, that's all from this lecture. Thank you.